All right. We've got 5 more weeks of school. It's time to put on some steam. You've all had a spring break. Who heard some interesting music during their spring break that they'd like to tell us about? Yes, ma'am.
I went to a restaurant in Encinitas, California, and heard mariachi.
Okay.
They were playing some pretty crazy stuff at the Comic Palooza in Houston.
I don't imagine. Anybody else? Ms. Nguyen?
I went to Chicago, and I heard a guy playing saxophone on the street, and I told him he had a heterogeneous sound.
Did he appreciate your information?
He just like...
Yeah, well, you knew more about it than he did. Anybody else?
I heard a noise band. I went down to First Fridays in Kansas City last Friday, and yeah, it was really crazy. It was really odd. There were people dancing to it, but I don't know how they were dancing to it because there was no beat, so...
Okay. Anybody else?
So, Jeremy Davenport, Nick Sherry, what's up? Jeremy Davenport and Mr. Sheridan in St. Louis.
Okay.
Steve, I heard the Imani Winds Woodwind Quintet in Kansas City.
Good. What did they play?
They did works from all of the... They did one piece that I remember called Five Poems on Birds. It's really interesting, but it was a very eclectic program. Took compositions that were American, some that were... had Middle Eastern influence and even some
fuzz
music.
All right. Okay, we need some victims here this morning. Let's start and give me a number between 1 and 5.
Three.
Okay, Ms. Coppett, come on down. Mr. Headings, come on down. Ms. Farhat, come on down. Mr. Park, come on down. Mr. Namati, come on down. Ms. Young, come on down. Ms. Nash, come on down. And Ms. Stokes, come on down.
And Ms. Harmon. Okay, I have to hold this.
All right, a couple pieces of information. First of all, I have passed out with grades our little experience with Charles Ives. If there's no one sitting and there is a piece of paper on their seat, send it down to me so it doesn't get lost in all the confusion. The other thing that concerns me is that there's at least 17 people for whom I did not have a paper. If you did not receive one, that means that I did not get one or one was not in my pile. So I'm going to send a little note to everybody to remind them, but we need to worry about this. And the other thing is, and I don't know how to impress this upon you, and I don't want to be mean and ugly on our first day back together, because I know you've missed me. But the simple fact is, educated people use standard English. I don't care where you come from or where you're going. It is a sign of an educated professional to use standard English. Writing in gobbledygook that you text each other is not standard English. There's two kinds of English. There's the kind that we talk to each other with every day and tell our deepest needs, and there's the kind that you offer in written English as a professional person. Some of you need to attend to this. In times past, I have asked people in this class to write a 2-page essay about Charles Ives because I believe that by my asking you to write about something makes you think about it and articulate it. I'm one of those people that thinks that we really don't know what we think until we have to articulate it in some powerful way. Gertrude Stein, who was Gertrude Stein? Anybody, who was Gertrude Stein? Nobody knows who Gertrude Stein was? Well, Gertrude Stein was an important literary figure who lived between the wars and was a self-exile in Paris and presided over one of the most remarkable salons of American artists that there ever were. And she was a prominent person in her own right. But she said, "I don't know what I think until I see what I say. I don't know what I think until I see what I say." There's something powerful about articulating ideas and putting them in a linear narrative for us to really know what we think. It is always going to be the mark of an educated person. I don't care how much technology you people have. It's never going to stand in for being able to think and being able to articulate. So I'm just putting you on warning. At the university, there's probably going to be someone who's going to be expect you to write in standard English. And if I were going to ask you to write another essay for me, I would expect that. I want you to know that several weeks ago, I watched a program on television that comforted me. It was a study of the students at MIT, who are supposedly some of the best students in the whole United States. And of course, they were very proud of the fact that they were wired 24 hours a day, every day of their life. And they were multitasking, they were texting, they were doing all these different things. And they have contempt for someone like me, a teacher who expects them to concentrate on one thing at a time. I am a dinosaur. I am something from the dark ages, because who on earth would concentrate on one thing at a time? But they performed a remarkable test on the students of MIT, and they discovered, as bright as they are, as technological as they are, they do not do the level of thinking that college students did 25 years ago, who didn't have all that technology. So there's several different things going on here. The technology is wonderful. I know you're all going to go out and buy your iPads or have people who love you buy them for you. But the fact that you can articulate your own thoughts and express them in an acceptable way is the mark of an educated person. And many of you, I understand, intend to be teachers. And this is going to become a part of your domain. And so you owe it to yourself to take this in hand. And of course, just like music making, how do you get to Carnegie Hall? You practice. How do you become a good musician? You practice and you listen carefully to music. How do you become an acceptable writer? You pay attention to your writing and you pay attention to your reading. They all go together. I know that some of you are looking in the air and thinking I'm a crazy person, but I'm just giving you a tip. An educated person, someone who is a professional, is able to articulate English, the lingua franca of our time, in our place, and some of you need to pay attention to it. There were some remarkable things that I read. I did not pay attention to it because I had not alerted you to this. But should I ever ask you to write again, I expect you to write in standard English. All right, we have had time away from each other and you've all been thinking about other things, and so it's important that we rethread the needle and we get back to where we were. Before we left each other, before we went off on our remarkable holidays, what were we concerned with in this class?
Gershwin.
We were concerned with Gershwin and Copeland. Why were we concerned with Gershwin and Copeland?
We were talking about the time between the wars.
We're talking about the time between the wars. World wars are major experiences in Western civilization, and they oftentimes are catalysts for changing ideas and things like that. So the two world wars serve as a very powerful set of bookends for a way of doing things, a way of thinking. What kind of music were we concerned with, or what ideas were in the music that we were concerned with about Gershwin and Copeland between the wars?
Klezmer music, kind of like some... their Jewish history.
Okay, well, there was an influence of klezmer music in the Gershwin, as well as many other kinds of things. But why are we studying it? Nationalism. She said the magic word. What is nationalism?
It's where they play music that's unique to their culture.
Why did she say they play music? This is about creating music to be played. But she's talking about creating music that serves a certain purpose. And what purpose is that?
To like reflect on their country and heritage.
Okay, and why? Why would you do that? Why would people in Czechoslovakia want Czech music? And why would people in Mexico want Mexican music? And why would people in Sweden want Swedish music?
Because it's their heritage.
And who was running the show for most of the time?
Someone who said that it was important.
The Germans and the French and the Italians. Remember my analogy of the swimming pools. There were three great big swimming pools in Europe for a long, long time. And then over the course of time, little swimming pools were built around it. And water, somebody jumped into the German pool and water went everywhere. It went to South America. It went to North America. And this nationalism thing is typically tied to perceived political oppression, that people do not have the opportunity to express themselves. Oftentimes, they're under the boot of, you know, an oppressor or a tyrant regime or something like that. In our case, it was imperialism. The German way was ruling the roost. Where was the German way ruling the roost, Mr. Park?
I don't know.
Help him out, Ms. Nash.
The Second New England School.
The Second New England School. All the most important musicians on the East Coast who ruled the show were drinking from the German trough. And then suddenly, Sean, who came to the United States and says, you people are going down the wrong path?
Dvorak.
Okay? He came and he said, American composers, break off your German yoke and write your own music for your own people. And how, Mr. Park, do nationalist composers do that? What is the procedure? What is the strategy?
They incorporate their folk tunes?
Yeah. One of the things they do is they turn to items or ideas that are very closely associated with a people, and we all know that this tends to be the music of the least of a society, the folk music, the folk dances, the folk songs. And so Dvorak said, Ms. Nash, Americans, it's all European over here, except there's only two ways to go.
African-American
music and Indian music. So everybody understands this. And we studied the Indianist movement that was prominent for a while, and now we're studying the music between the wars, in which for the first time on the grand scale, there was an American fine art music that was identifiably American. And you know what? When Americans go to Europe, the Germans don't want to hear Americans play Beethoven. Beethoven's theirs. They don't want to hear Americans play Brahms. Brahms is theirs. They want to hear Copland. They want to hear Gershwin. They want to hear Americans playing American music. And so we have this interesting tension. This building right here is a great tribute to the Germans. It still is. And on one level, there's nothing wrong with that. The Germans certainly knew how to write good music. But in most instances here, we are Americans. And I intend to do everything in my power to communicate to you the glory of the musical traditions in our own country. We have nothing to be ashamed of. And it is the wonderful nature of our brains that we do not have to give up Beethoven to embrace Copland. We do not have to give up Brahms to embrace Ella Fitzgerald. We do not have to give up Bach to embrace Cole Porter. We can have it all. And so I want you to open up your hearts and understand that important things are going on. Now, this business about the Indians and the African Americans was problematic. Why was it problematic?
A lot of the Indian musical traditions were wiped out when Europeans...
All right, yeah, the Europeans had decimated American Indian culture. And even more important than that, where were the American Indians in the system to write this music? There were no American Indians being trained at the Ivy League schools with the Germanic teachers. Where would they learn how to do this? You know, that sometimes to apply a trade, you need the tools of the trade. You know, if I walked over to the medical school and said, I want to be a heart surgeon, and they would say, what's your education, what's your experience? And I say, well, I don't have any. It's very unlikely that they would let me crack open somebody's body and go to work on them. So if you don't have the training, you don't get to play the game. So that was a big problem, and it was also a problem because American Indian culture had very little impact on the mainstream culture. There were not very many people, you know, thinking that they were... In fact, there was the construction of the American Indian as a cunning, nasty, mean-spirited guy who will take your scalp off. Why would you want to glorify him? And then there comes the problem with the African Americans, Sean. But what was the secret here? What was the surprise with the African American music? Was there someone who came along who could do it? Mm-hmm. And what was his name?
William Grant Still.
William Grant Still was an African-American composer who was educated at Oberlin, who has a proud tradition of educating African-American musicians. He studied with all kinds of important people, and he did, in fact, do something remarkable. And what was the remarkable thing that he did?
He
He wrote the entire symphony?
He wrote the first symphony by an African American in the United States during the Harlem Renaissance. And, Mr. Park, what was the Harlem Renaissance?
It was a culmination of blues. I don't know.
Okay, help him out. What was the Harlem Renaissance? All right, this is one for you all to remember because I'm very keen on the Harlem Renaissance.
It's like where they took pride in their like art and culture and stuff.
All right, the Harlem Renaissance is this cultural flowering of African-American art in Harlem, the most important African-American city in the United States. Poets and novelists and painters and musicians of all kinds flourished in Harlem because at that point and by that point, the leaders of African-American society had understood that Booker T. Washington's strategy would not work. What was Booker T. Washington's strategy?
To assimilate.
To assimilate. They tried, it didn't work. So the leaders of the Harlem Renaissance published a tract called The New Negro. And the new Negro was to have pride in himself and pride in herself. And he and she was to turn not completely to the mainstream traditions, but in fact to their own traditions. But there was an interesting tension in all this. And what was the tension? What was the tension? All right, let us pretend that we are African-American artists in the Harlem Renaissance. She's a novelist, she's a poet, he's an artist, he's a musician. What are we going to do? Well, she's going to write a novel. A novel is a European genre. But she's going to pour it with an African-American set of characters, an African-American plot, an African-American dialogue. Okay? She's going to transform it. But the vessel is European, but the content is going to be African-American. He's going to write a symphony. He's going to use an orchestra. Those are very powerful European ideas. But he's going to make it his own in several ways. What is he going to do with it?
Make it bluesy.
He's going to add the blues, the most powerful secular music of African-Americans historically, and
Blues and spirituals.
And he's going to manipulate those musics as a sonata form for the first movement of his symphony, which he titles Afro-American Symphony. When music has a title like that, we call it what? What kind of category of music do we call that? Program music. We're supposed to be thinking about something non-musical. It's not just about the sounds. It's telling a story. It's painting a picture. It's an espousing a point of view. And on top of that, he assigned poems to each movement in African-American dialect. And unlike the minstrel show that used African-American dialect as a source of ridicule, now they're using African-American dialect as a source of pride. Okay, so we've had lots of interesting things going on. William Grant still is authentic. And when I played that piece and I said, and this has been said to me many times, why that music sounds like Gershwin. And I pointed out to you what important thing, Ms. Kopic?
That Gershwin was not authentic.
Right, that Gershwin is the imitator and William Grant still is the authentic. Because Gershwin was interested in African American music. He is going to write Porgy and Bess, which is a plot about black characters and black situation, and he's going to be greatly influenced by African-American musical traditions. He's going to synthesize them with the European. Remember that one of the wonderful things about our culture is this ability to acculturate different traditions and different points of view, and so that's very powerful. And the piece that we studied, or we listened to for a little while, was Rhapsody in Blue, and what kind of American music was Gershwin using when he did that? Ms. Nash?
Jazz.
Jazz. And of course, the condition is that at that time in American culture, any fast, bouncy, syncopated music was referred to as jazz. Okay? So he's going to, the expression was, he was trying to make a lady out of jazz. He was taking her from the brothel and putting her in the concert hall. But you have to understand that the nature of that music that so many of us find engaging today and, you know, kind of remarkable for its immediate appeal was shocking in 1925. The idea that jazz, a music associated with the red light district in New Orleans, should be heard in a concert hall in New York City was blasphemous. And there were all kinds of people getting their fingers out and wagging it because they thought that this was absolutely misguided, absolutely wrong. And of course, they were wrong. And Rhapsody in Blue is still around. And their ideas are long gone away. So we have the creation of a body of music that is in fact going to be American. Now, the person who is going to ride this crest and become the most important figure in the creation of American music is none other than, who is the great American composer of concert music in the 20th century?
Aaron Copland.
Write his name down and spell it correctly. Remember that his family name was changed when they came from Russia. He grew up in Brooklyn, and his life was very unmusical. And he is a very unusual candidate for becoming the one who creates the sound of our concert music. But he did, it happened that way, and we have to take it seriously. What is interesting and unusual about Aaron Copland? What's one thing? All right, now think about this. Wouldn't you imagine that the person who is going to represent everybody in the United States would be someone who was kind of ordinary in the sense of the United States? Mm-hmm. Wouldn't you think it would be some Midwesterner? I'm kind of a big believer that the Midwest is the real United States, you know? Things that happen in New York City and San Francisco are kind of weird, but what we're doing right here in the middle, this is the real stuff. When the Europeans come to the United States, they should come to the Midwest because we're the real deal. We're not the eccentricities on the edges. I went to a wedding one time. I was the best man at a wedding in San Francisco, and the people there simply couldn't keep it straight whether I was from Ohio, Iowa, or Idaho, because they had no concept of Ohio, Iowa, and Idaho. At least we know where San Francisco is, and we pretend to know what's going on there. All right, but the important point is, what is interesting and unusual about Aaron Copland? Sean?
He was very poor.
He was poor.
He was a homosexual.
He was a homosexual.
And he was Jewish.
He was Jewish. And once again, one of the things that I want you to become sensitive to is the remarkable contribution to our culture, fine art culture and popular culture, from members of groups in our society that were seriously discriminated against. Seriously discriminated against. There were, you know, I don't know whether you know this, back in the old days when you applied to school, to go to college, you had to send your picture. Why did you have to send your picture, Ms. Kopic?
To make sure they weren't allowing anybody they didn't really
know. Yeah, that's how they screen people. No people of color. And of course, I think I told you that one of the most, one of the most memorable pieces of paper I ever saw was a one ad page from a New York newspaper in the 1920s that had a cross next to every job that was available that meant only Christians are going to get this job. This is the reason why many Jewish people changed their last name to assimilate into the mainstream. If you were a person of color, if you were a different ethnic group or something, you were not accepted at most universities, or if you were accepted, there was a quota, a certain number, that only this many of this could be accepted in the freshman class. Only this many of this. All those things were ingrained, and they were institutional. What else, Sean?
He studied music in Paris underneath.
All right, he didn't go the normal route. He didn't go to one of the Ivy League schools and study with a teacher in the second New England school like Charles Ives did. And by the way, Charles Ives was not an insurance salesman. He didn't go door-to-door selling insurance. Charles Ives was an insurance executive. He was the boss. He was at the top. He made lots of money. He created estate planning, which many of you will be involved in when you become wealthy. All right, what else about Aaron Copland?
He While in Paris, he studied underneath the female Natalia.
All right, this is very important. He went to Paris. Why did he go to Paris?
Because we were at war with Germany.
Yeah, we beat Germany. We weren't going to go study with the losers. He went to Paris because, of course, we couldn't stay home. We had to go to Europe to get the pedigree. And when he was in Paris, he began a relationship of a teacher-student with a woman named Nadia Boulanger. Nadia Boulanger. And what was so interesting about Nadia Boulanger, in addition to the fact that she was a woman, most of the great composition teachers, historically at least, were men. And the system worked like an apprentice. You would learn with a certain teacher, and you'd learn to write music his way, and then maybe you might try to write it your way. If you're an apprentice to a carpenter, you learn to build a house his way before you build your own house. But this wasn't the deal with Nadia Boulanger. She wasn't a great composer. She was a great teacher. And what did she teach? What did she believe? What was so distinctive about Nadia?
You should make music the way you wanted to.
Well, I suppose you can, that's one way to say it, but what she believed deeply was that American composers should not write European music. She thought that American composers should write American music, not French music, not German music, and so she is going to become this fountain, and both Aaron Copland and Virgil Thompson, who's going to be the next composer that we're going to study, both began studying composition with Nadia Boulanger, and she encouraged them to create music that Americans could identify with. She also encouraged them to write modern music, that it should not be the kind of music that was written back in the 19th century, that the world had turned many times since then, and there was absolutely no reason to write in an outdated style. She wanted to be up to date. She wanted them to be up to date. Okay? So keep this context in mind because it's important. And we studied, I started to study a piece by Aaron Copland called A Lincoln Portrait. What is interesting and significant about A Lincoln Portrait?
There's narrative during it.
There is a narrative doing it. And why did he do that?
It was supposed to be like kind of an inspiring thing during the time of the war.
It was written during World War II. And once again, when we listen to it today, we think, you know, how interesting and how American, and we all love Abraham Lincoln. But at that time, when they did that, when he did that, it had an emotional power that none of us can fully appreciate, I don't think. I don't think that we can understand what it felt like and what it sounded like to hear those words of Lincoln and that American concert music at a time when the people in the United States did not know whether they were going to win the war. It was not a foregone conclusion. People did not know. Once again, we think, well, of course we won. We're us. But that isn't necessarily the way it was. And every person in the room that heard this probably knew someone or had a relative who had been murdered in the war. So that the emotional framework is, in fact, remarkable. Why did he use the words of Abraham Lincoln?
He liked Abraham Lincoln. And a great man, I guess, of American history.
Well, but don't you understand? There would be nobody in the United States that could not relate to Abraham Lincoln. Everybody revered Abraham Lincoln. He's thought to be one of our very greatest presidents. And so once again, nationalists turn to ideas and symbols and emblems that people will automatically relate to. Okay? We're going to study a piece of music next called The River. And it isn't just any river. It's the Mississippi River that should mean something probably to everybody in this room. So by turning to national symbols, to national literature, Mark Twain, you know, all that kind of stuff, they were cultivating a culture of Americana, something that people could take pride in. All right, I argued that this piece was put together in three different parts. What was the purpose of the first part? What's the purpose of the first part? You've all been off doing weird things. Let's listen to a little bit of this and see what you think.
Let's do a fun week.
Already, this doesn't sound like any of the music that we've studied before, does it? Doesn't it sound different somehow? What's different about it? Well, maybe. Yeah, there's lots of influence on building harmony in fourths and not thirds. This causes that kind of hollow, open kind of sound. Where do those fourths come from? Folk song. Another interesting thing is that when people hear the music of Aaron Copland, they hear all this space. And many commentators have compared this, supposedly, to the space in the United States of America. Wide open, big country. And he does this by having some pitches up in the stratosphere, some pitches in the middle, and some pitches way down in the bottom. When we've heard orchestral music in the past, we've been treated to families of instruments. Here he uses the strings as the foundation, but then we have all these solo instruments with all these interesting colors, brass instruments, and woodwinds. It's kind of lean, clean, and mean. Now, what did I argue was the purpose of this first part of the music? What's going on here? What is Aaron Copland doing? He's telling us about the nature of Abraham Lincoln. Stubborn. He was melancholy. He was humble. He was principled. And all these dotted rhythms make reference to the war. Dotted rhythms come from marches, which are martial. But it also gives us something about Abraham Lincoln. What kind of person he was. Now, this little melody here is Aaron Copland's treatment of taps. What is taps? Yeah, it's a military tattoo for the dead. Of course, this is about Gettysburg, and it's about World War II, and it's about national service. Serious, because he keeps punctuating the music with these melodramatic punctuations. Da-da! In the 1950s, during the Red Scare. Now, this is the second section right here. What's going on now? What kind of music is this? Thank you. Sunshine. He's giving us words to it in the conclusion. He's associating musical gestures with words. We can't escape history.
We of this Congress and this administration will be remembered in spite of ourselves. No personal significance or insignificance can spare one or another of us. The fiery trial through which we pass will light us down in honor or dishonor to the latest generation. We, even we here, hold the power and bear the responsibility.
Just that word, Kentucky.
Raised in Indiana.
Indiana.
And lived in Illinois.
Heaven.
And this is what he said. This is what Abe Lincoln said.
Hear the dotted rhythm. This is what he said.
The dogmas of the quiet past.
He was principled.
Inadequate to the song.
He was stubborn. He was idealistic.
The occasion
he was
is
honest.
High with difficulty, and we must rise with the occasion. As our case is new, so we must think anew and act anew. We must disenthrall ourselves, and then we shall save our country.
Remember that Lincoln was talking about the Civil War. Aaron Copland is talking about World War II.
When standing erect, he was 6 feet 4 inches tall. And this is what he said. He said, "It is the eternal struggle between two principles, right and wrong, throughout the world. It is the same spirit that says, you toil and work and earn bread, and I'll eat it. no matter in what shape it comes, whether from the mouth of a king who seeks to bestride the people of his own nation and live by the fruit of their labor, or from one race of men as an apology for enslaving another race. It is the same tyrannical principle. Lincoln was a quiet and a melancholy man. But when he spoke of democracy, this is what he said. He said, "As I would not be a slave, so I would not be a master."
The Nazis and the Japanese were enslaving people all over the world.
Whatever differs from this, to the extent of the difference, there's no remorse. Abraham Lincoln, 16th President of these United States, is everlasting in the memory of his country. For on the battleground at Gettysburg, this is what he said.
There's the again, stylized
that
taps.
From these honored dead, we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, and that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, and for the people shall not perish from the earth.
American nationalism. And you know, it's not lost on me that today people your age are going to lay down their lives for us. We are in war right now. But think of how different the environment that we're living in. You know, we're not sacrificing because people are dying in our names. It's a completely different ballgame. But maybe someone will write some important music about what's happening to us right now. All right, what kind of instruments did you hear in this that you didn't hear in earlier music, Mr. Park? Did you hear any instruments that you'd never heard before?
No.
Mr. Namathi?
Uh,
tuba wasn't really used in a lot of European music.
Well, but this is the history. You have to know the history. When the orchestra was started, it was the handmaiden of the ballet and the opera. It came into its existence as a helpmate. It did not stand on its own. Only slowly over the course of time did the orchestra become an independent operation. And at that point, in the second half of the 18th century, it was primarily a string affair. Okay? In the first part of the 19th century, because of the new middle-class audience who was not sophisticated and had to be hit over the head every once in a while, composers began to become interested in giving them some new sounds. In fact, the Romantics even made a science out of it. They called it orchestration. And the first new sounds that were featured were what sounds, Mr. Namati? The woodwinds, the flutes, the oboes. And, of course, the French horn, which was AC/DC. But then we get to the second half of the 19th century, and you know what? Those woodwind and strings, they just don't do it for me anymore. I want more. The Romantics believe that more is more. What did composers give them?
The brass.
You betcha, and that's why the brass people love Mahler and love Brahms. Gave them something to do, okay? And the music is changed and intensified by the addition of the brass. The woodwinds are still there, very important. And the strings, of course, are the important foundation for everything. But the new sound of the second half of the 19th century is that brass stuff, as in Indian Suite Number 2. You all remember that. But then when we get to the 20th century, what happens to the orchestra? What's the new stuff? What's the new pepper? What's the new spice? Absolutely. Percussion instruments. There was xylophone in this. There was gongs. There were timpani drums. There were all kinds of new sounds to intensify things. And this is an important part of this. All right, we're almost done, but I want to tell you one more story and then we'll go our way for today. Aaron Copland was the individual who created the sound of our American concert music. It is undeniable. He didn't use this sound in everything that he wrote, but a major portion of his music has this accessible sound that most of us embrace and appreciate. But when in 1952, when President Eisenhower was elected, they wanted to give a performance of a Lincoln portrait as his inauguration. And one congressman stood up and said, "Aaron Copland is a communist." He was called before the House committee. He was kind of genial and grandfatherly and kind of, you know, talked to them. But his whole career was on the line. The single most important person in American fine art music, the one who in fact had created our fine art sound, was being interrogated by Congress and was on the verge of losing every shred of a reputation that he ever had for ideas that he had been associated with when he was a young man. I want you to remember this. Things that you are doing today, friends that you have today, may come back when you're powerful and bite you, you know where. There were a whole bunch of important creative people who were blackballed. Their careers were ended. Some of them were associated with Hollywood. Some of them were great actors, novelists, poets, all kinds of important people, because there was a witch hunt for communists after World War II during the Cold War. And people who had been open-minded when they were young and had not been interested in, you know, absolutist views, but had looked around, they were scrutinized and their lives were turned upside down. And remember that during the Great Depression, which was an important part of all this, it looked like Western civilization had failed. When thinking people looked at the world that they lived in, they thought that maybe there were some reasons to explore some other ideas. If this system gives us a system where people give up their babies because they can't feed them, maybe there's something wrong with the system. If this system lets people create a lot of wealth and it disappears overnight, and they all jump out of windows of high buildings and kill themselves, maybe there's something wrong with the system. If we have a system where some group of people don't have the same rights as another group of people, maybe there's something wrong with the system. And creative people and thinking people actually embraced some of those ideas and suffered for it towards the prime of their lives. The Red Scare. We'll talk about it again. See you next time.